Hello and welcome to Take This TV, the television book club podcast, where each week we watch an episode or two of our favorite shows and we talk about them with our friends of the fandom, which happens to be you. I'm Carmen Askernese, and I'm joined as always by the amazing Kimberly Woods. Hello.
Hey, hot potatoes.
This season we're watching Fallout.
And today we're on episode 4 called The Ghouls. The episode description this week is Death to Management.
Yeah. Woo! Eat the rich.
In this episode, we learn about Vault 32, which we knew was a little sus.
We did.
Yep. So we have Norm and Chet getting to explore further kind of the darkness that's happened there, because some of the raiders who Norm is now watching over as a prison guard had mentioned kind of how horrible they were, basically alluding to they weren't very good people to begin with. So Norm goes to check it out.
He does. I feel like I really like Norm. I thought he was annoying in the beginning, but he's growing on me a lot, because I'm like, there is something going on with the vaults and everybody else is just content to like ignore it. But I love that Norm is trying to figure out what's happening. And then he discovers that the raiders were let into the vault by his mom's, is it Pit Boy?
Yeah.
Is that what the things
are
called?
Yeah, yeah, Pit Boy. Yeah, and their biosignals like had been wiped out like 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Also, there's that moment when the ghoul asks Lucy, when he has her tied up, and he's like, what did you say your name was again? And she says, Lucy McLean. And he's like, McLean. And I was like, oh, is her family like connected to like Vault Tech in some kind of way? And like, is she a descendant of some of them? Like, yeah.
Yeah. And I thought he was like reacting again, like, is this your mother? Because the raider before, like, now it's kind of coming full circle. Like, but before she left, she told Lucy, you look like your mother.
Mm-hmm.
So that raider knew of her mother too. And then the ghoul seems to know of her mother, maybe her father, but that name, like you're saying. And then he's, because Lucy is saying something like, you know, how they had a hard period of time where people were starving and her mother starved. And he says something like, there's what people say they did and what they really did.
Yeah.
And I'm like, ooh.
When, as he calls it, he's making ass jerky. Yeah.
Oh, that was disgusting. But back in Vault 32, there's some really crazy stuff happening. People look like they strangled each other with their hands. They've written, we know the truth, on the walls. And then they also have like death to management written. And the overseer has been tied up at his desk.
Yeah. Got murked.
Yeah. And we know, like, from the games, like, usually some of the vaults are associated with different social experiments. So it's like, okay, is this a social experiment that went wrong? What's the deal here? What did they find out?
So we learned in a previous episode that Vault 31, 32, and 33 are all connected, sort of like in this triangle of a community. And they were sharing breeders and other resources between the vaults. And so I wonder if the experiment was like, can these three communities, because they wanted to have an odd number of communities probably, to see if they could all coexist. And it seems like maybe, because we haven't really learned much about Vault 31. And so I'm like, how is Vault 31 involved in this? Maybe
which is where her dad's from, right?
Yeah. Lucy's dad is from Vault 31. Well, he says he is, but we don't know. We don't know.
That's what people say and what they actually did.
So I don't know. Like, maybe the people in Vault 32 found out the truth about what the Vault experiment was, or maybe they found out the truth that the surface world was inhabited by folks who were suffering or something. I don't know.
We'll see. I'm excited to learn more because I love these little like mysteries and lore in the games.
Yes. I love the mystery too. I'm always like, of all these wild theories, just like writing stuff down as I'm watching it. Get my little Sherlock on, like, oh, this is it.
We also get introduced to Roger.
We do.
Who is unfortunately turning when we meet him. And we see our ghoul do a kind of merciful thing where he puts him out of his misery. He has him reflect on a nice memory and then kills him before he can turn. So that was kind of sweet.
It was, but it makes me think about like what I learned about when they slaughter cattle and stuff. And it's like if the cows are happy, then the meat is better or something like
Ew.
That.
Okay, so you're saying it's like purely selfish reasons. For that sweet, sweet jerky.
Because the ghoul's like, sometimes a fella's got to eat a fella. Which I didn't know he was going to eat him. But
that was... I couldn't watch that. I think we were also eating ourselves, and I was like, I can't eat right now while this is happening. Let me just like look down during this section. I love the golden rule coming back into effect here in this episode. There's a moment where Lucy drinks from the radiated bucket of water, which he later calls like animal piss or something, because... the ghoul won't give her a drink of his. And she, like, bites his finger. And
bites
then he bites it off. And then he, in turn, bites hers off. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And he's like, that's the closest thing to an honest exchange we've had yet.
Man. As she bit his finger off and he's like, there's that little killer. I was like, oh no, Lucy's turning. But I think she still kind of stays true to her beliefs. Even though she's struggling to survive in the wasteland.
I think her encounter with the super duper Mart really changes her. We have the ghoul trying to trade her for some vials of his medicine. And we get introduced to the robot butler, which in the game sometimes can be like a companion. Yeah. But this one wants her organs.
Yeah, he's like, you're not going to be a sex slave. I'm just going to harvest your organs.
Oh, God, the fudge. The fudge callback after he's like trying to hack. It's really funny. Yeah. There's no fudge.
The two guys in there, like, I guess they're scavengers or whatever. They refer to the robot as Snip Snip. So,
oh, yeah.
Snip Snip is trying to harvest Lucy's organs, but thankfully there's a defibrillator in there and she short circuits him, which I thought was like a fun way to have that go down. Because I was like, how is she going to fight this giant robot? But I thought that was really clever.
I thought it was funny afterwards when she goes to those two guys and she's like, you know, does she actually ask for them to be released at first?
Yeah, she tells them to release everybody, but then they don't release the ghouls.
She's like, I'm going to kill the robot. I'm going to kill Snip Snip, basically, if you don't let them go. And they're like, so? Why do we care about the robot?
Poor Snip Snip. They don't care.
Yeah. But then she threatens them with, was it some sort of poison? Something that has poison in it.
Yeah,
she's like, Snip Snip, explain what medicine. This does.
And when like she shoots a warning dart and like starts to corrode the couch, and I was like, dang, what kind of poison is that?
So they do let some of the people go, but not all. And then Lucy's like, no, I said everybody. And she doesn't realize what she's doing. I'm like, oh, Lucy, oh, sweet, sweet girl. You just saw Roger earlier. Oh boy. So the ones that they were holding back were the ghouls that were either right about to turn or had already turned. So basically they released a bunch of zombies and chaos broke out.
And everybody died.
Yep. Everybody died.
The scene with Mary was really sad, where like the one of the ghouls who hadn't quite turned yet, she was trying to remember her human side. But wasn't able to resist the urge and ended up attacking Lucy, and Lucy had to put her down. Yeah. And I was like, dang.
And Lucy was trying to get her to remember too and didn't want to have to put her down, but the unfortunate circumstances of the wasteland.
It's a savage world.
I think it's funny too, because by the time she comes out of the super duper mart, She's dirty. She just has half of her vault tech suit off. She's like bandaged up. She's grabbed some boots from like mismatched boots. And I was watching with Andrew and he was like, she went from fudge to motherfucker in the course of a super duper mart.
Yeah, she turned into Samuel L. Jackson by the end.
We get the golden rule again because she comes out and she does give the ghoul his vials despite him having turned her in. And cut she her says, finger off. Yeah, cutting her finger off. And she's like, I may end up looking like you, but I will never be you. Golden rule, motherfucker.
Hell yeah.
I just loved it so much. I was like, that's such a good line.
It was good. I love the like music, the heroic music swelling as she's walking away. Yeah, I was like, that's awesome. I also love the like symbolism of like Ash, she's kind of shedding her vault tech suit and it's like she's kind of shedding some of her ideals so that she can survive, but she's not giving up who she is. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I thought that was really cool. This show has been so great and the characters are a lot of fun.
Yeah, we didn't get to see Maximus this episode.
No, I wonder what he's up to, because I was really curious after last episode, because when they got the head I was like, is he going to be welcomed back? Because he's going to have to get out of the suit and they're going to realize that he's not Titus. So,
And I had this brief thought too when she was like walking the wasteland with one boot. I was like, did Maximus grab her boot and is it going to be like a Cinderella moment where he like brings her boot back? Like, it fits.
Oh man, who's the one Greek character? And it's like, oh, he's going to like save everybody or whatever. And because he has one shoe and. Oh geez, I'm like misremembering this fable, but I think it was I keep wanting to say Jason and the Argonauts. I don't think that's the story though. It's anyway, if you know what I'm talking about, let us know in the comments. Like the Greek character, and it's like, oh, this person is going to like they're gonna like rule the kingdom or like save the kingdom or something like that. And so the king, because of this prophecy, is trying to like prevent this person from coming about, but then the person shows up and they have one shoe just like the prophecy foretold, and it's like, oh, this person's gonna be the savior or whatever. And so I always love when stories have like a character like this and they go to a new world and like, oh, they lose their shoe, and it's like, I feel like it's like a little subtle way to be like, our hero is kind of like, you know, they're lost and they're finding their way in this new world, but they're eventually going to get their wits about them and save the day. So I think Lucy is starting to come into herself as a hero.
Yeah, I love her so much. I'm really, really enjoying it. Yeah. We get to see the ghoul see himself in his old movies again. Once he goes into the Super Duper Mart and is blessed with all those vials and delicious stores they have. And he's just like digging into all that stuff.
Doing all the drugs, drinking all the alcohol.
Pouring it into his hat. I'm like, wait, why are you taking it out of the box?
Yeah, it's like it's literally in a box. Just take the box.
Yeah, what's happening? But he sees himself, and I was wondering, like, do you think that perhaps Lucy will kind of remind him of who he was more?
Oh, 100%. And I also think that, like, because we saw him do that scene previously. He told the director he felt like his character was a hero and wouldn't shoot that guy. But in the version of the tape that we see is like the complete version of the film, where the scene plays out like the director wanted, where he shoots the guy who's begging for mercy. And so I feel like him seeing Lucy get, like, show him mercy and help him reminds him of who he used to be. And then him watching that scene as the director wanted it to be is kind of like seeing what he turned into today. And so I feel like this is going to be a pivotal moment for him, and probably he'll start to come around and help Lucy. So I'm
excited. So much.
We also see, is it Cousin Chet? Is that the cousin's name?
Yeah. Oh gosh. Chet. Cousin Chet
is feeling, he's down bad, and he's feeling like he's his whole life has fallen apart. His true love, Lucy, his cousin, is gone. And he lost his job as the keeper of the door. But what is the other character's name who was Lucy's best friend? Who is
Eye Patch Lady?
Yeah.
I don't remember
her name, but she brings Chet some of her dead husband Bert, I believe is the husband's name. She brings him some of Bert's stuff, and she's like,
Stephanie, that's her name.
Stephanie.
Apparently.
So Stephanie brings Chet some of Bert's stuff. And she I love when she gives him Bert's shoe. And I didn't like rewind it to check, but I was like, is the shoe getting smaller every time they cut away and cut back to it? Because it seemed like the shoe was getting smaller.
I didn't notice that. That's funny.
But yeah, I was definitely like, oh, they're going to hook up. And
yeah. Doesn't she say something right before, like, you should fill his shoes or?
Well, she was saying
like,
that.
Like, literally?
She literally, was like, she wanted him to wear his shoes, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But, like, she wanted him to really step into that role. And then yeah, he did.
She did. But then the baby was on the way, which was...
A... Water broke. Oh, gosh, that was fun. He was down for it, though. He was fully committed to his part. He's like, I'm Bert.
I'm Bert now.
Yeah, got sweater, I'm Bert. Oh, I thought boy. It was funny too, because then that's when Norm comes to rescue him, like, you want to get out of here after the war?
He's like, yes, please. I also love that scene when Norm talks to one of the council members. I also don't remember her name, but I love the conversation that they have, and she warns Norm that, like, he's, you know, he's really intelligent, he's really clever, and it can be dangerous if he doesn't know how to deal with and properly handle his anger, and saying things like they should all kill the bandits will influence people because his name carries a lot of weight. And I thought that was a cool, it reminded me of, like, I talk a lot with my friends about how I don't like Yoda, and I feel like Yoda is one of the worst characters in Star Wars, because Anakin Skywalker, this kid that they took from his mom when he was a little kid, comes to them and is like, oh, Mr. Frogmaster, I'm having these horrible dreams. I need help. And he's just like, well, you know, if you get mad, then it's going to be the dark side or whatever. So I love this scene where she kind of, like, warns Norm that, like, hey, you shouldn't do that kind of stuff, but, like, in an empathetic way where you could tell that she cares about him, because she mentions, like, when he was a kid and the first time he ever tried pie, and so you could tell that, like, she feels some affection for him and wants the best for him, but also wants to let him know that, like, it's dangerous for you to act on your emotions like that.
Yeah, I'm excited to see what happens next, Carmen.
I love this show. Yeah, I'm excited to see what happens. I don't know what's going to happen, because now Lucy has lost the head. I guess she's going to try to find Maximus, so we'll see.
Yeah, we'll see. Thank you all so much for joining us. Don't forget, we're at Take This TV on TikTok and Instagram. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. You can watch us on our YouTube channel. And remember, it's dangerous to watch TV alone.